School, Sociology, and I'm delighted to see everybody here today. This is actually our second seminar this week for our school, so we're busy. I know that there are some folk in the audience who maybe this is their first time to the School of Sociology, so you're very welcome. We're delighted to have you here. Today we're going to talk about a research project that's going on in the school on social networks and patient healthcare, which we have nicknamed PatNet because of the kind of technology we're using within the project and the ambition behind the project. So PatNet stands for Patient Network. And so I'm delighted to introduce you to Dr. Nasim Mahmud, who is a social computing expert, but with a large curiosity about how his work integrates with the behavioural and social sciences, and that's really where his space is in terms of the PatNet project. I'm also delighted to introduce you to Travis Tatum, who is working as the doctoral researcher on the project, but he's only in his first year, so he's just going to say a couple of words at the end of the presentation to give you a flavour of the kind of work he's hoping to do on his PhD project. I'm not going to say much more about Nasim. Nasim, I'd like you to tell us about your areas of expertise briefly, and then maybe to begin the presentation. So the presentation will run for about 45 minutes in total, I think, maybe a little bit more, and then we have time for questions and answers at the end of that. Okay, thanks very much.
Thank you for coming, and I think for the presentation duration, I think it should be slightly longer.
Okay.
So if you have questions, it's better you ask immediately, or after that, we will also have some time. So today's topic, talking about connected living, and social computing and human sensor network. And you can see this is slightly disjoint areas, apparently, but we will see how it is connected. And I am Nasim Mahmud, postdoctoral research fellow working with Dan in computational social science, and I have a degree in social computing and computer science. So today's agenda, we will talk about connected living. So connected living itself is a very wide area of research, but we will focus on aging population and illness. And then we will talk about social computing and looking at how we look at the society within this domain. And we try to explain how we understand society and how we can provide service within this domain area of research. And we will also talk about human sensor network. And as Dan already introduced, that we will talk about PatNet projects, so that we fall actually in this segment. But I will not follow this order. I will start with social computing, then I will go to connected living, and then I will finish with PatNet. So connectedness. In the world, connectedness or being connected with people should live its power. So how are we connected with each other? For example, if this tiny little boy is maybe playing his violin, is it connected with this person? So I will try to explain how it works later. But what do you think? How is this guy connected with this person? Maybe someone want to volunteer? So this is a very well-known example, 6 degrees of separation. Milgram ran a test and he wanted to see how people are connected with each other, and he found that people, well, any person is connected with someone else, maybe completely in the other part of the world, on average in 6 degrees of separation. And this research was done in 1960s or 60, most particularly 1967. But how is it the situation in this present world? So now we have social network, we have Facebook, we have Twitter, and so on. On Facebook, this level of separation is 4.74 hops. That means two persons, even if you don't know him, are like only 4 or 5 hops away from you. And on Twitter, it's 4.6. So Twitter is much closer, and it's also much earlier. But how can we use this information? And how can we help? How can we support ourselves or our behavior with this information? That's a big question. So we can use this information for social mobilization. So, for example, we can use the power of our social network. We can use the connected group. For example, if I know someone, and he has someone who has a job, so I can actually apply for a job through him. So this is called strength of weak ties. And especially for finding partners, life partners, it is a very, very well-known approach. And marketing companies are companies that produce different kind of services or products. They can focus on how to target their people. At the same time, we can also target people and provide help or necessary information. In terms of disaster, we can provide information. So this is one of the first examples. So I will slowly start with the known examples, and then I think it will be interesting for you. Then I will slowly forward to do little complex examples, and we'll come back to our work. So back in 1995, this is a call in China that someone asked for help. A person was suffering from some illness, and so they wanted to raise funding. Normally what we do is like we go to people or just collect money physically, but this is the first approach, a first digital invitation for raising funds. And the same approach, so in that example, people contributed money, but what we can contribute in digital world, like people can now write a blog, some information, and then they can share it. So we normally do it for ourselves, for maybe our own happiness. But if we can put all of this knowledge together, that can become a big encyclopedia, which is actually Wikipedia. So using the same philosophy or same approach, there are many other services. We will slowly go there. So this is one of the most earliest example that utilizes social computing, and it brings the power of the society, power of the people together to come up with one solution. I think in mid-90s, there was a call where they asked people to contribute with one word, an explanation of the word and how this word is being used. And they ended up with 6 million submissions, and it took nearly 70 years. But at the end, we have found this Oxford Dictionary. So it is one of the earliest examples of social computing, but we normally refer to Wikipedia because it's widely known. And some social computing examples are really ubiquitous, that even we do not recognize that it is not done by one table, rather a group of people contributing all together. So for example, this Apache example. So all the websites we use, or most of them, not all, if not all, most of the websites we use running on Apache or Apache related servers. And for example, this Linux community or Firefox community, people are contributing and they're doing just for their own pleasure. Or maybe they are learning themselves, but we are using the benefit. So one person somewhere in the world is contributing, giving his intelligence or his workforce, and we are getting the benefit. So this is the basic concept of social computing. And this is a simple picture, but I would ask someone to explain what is this. What do you understand from this?
This where somebody has chosen that this is the best way to route over the hill.
Thank you very much. Yeah, somebody has chosen that this is the best way through the hill. Or maybe a lot of people passed from this path, and that's why there's a mark on the field. But when we go there, we actually do not think that someone has created this, because that someone did it willingly without thinking of someone who will be benefited from it. So with that, we just follow that path. So this is called social navigation. We follow people. And how can we translate it into computer or into digital life? Because we are becoming more and more connected, and we are living more digital life. So if we just translate the same concept, it comes here. So let's say delicious or digs. So whenever you are reading one newspaper or one scientific article, you are just tagging it, okay, it looks nice, or you're just giving some keywords, okay, for your search. But later, maybe another researcher is looking for something, and he's just searching that your keywords now become vital for that next person to find this particular article. But you did it only for yourself. And again, so another person is tagging and you are getting the benefit. And this is the most popular social navigation example, Amazon. So sometimes, and if I may ask, like, have you tried to buy something on Amazon? Maybe I ask Diane. So did you find this like when you are trying to buy something, there's a list of other items and it says, person bought this item, also explored this or bought this. So this is the real world, human behavior has been translated into a computational form, so that people, now we do that without thinking about it, and we think, okay, so I am going to buy this book, and the person who bought this book has also read the second book. Maybe I also need to buy that one. And so I gave a small example. So I would like you to volunteer to come up with a little more list, maybe from Travis, if you want to say anything.
A list of
things where someone is doing something but another person is getting the benefit. Say you bought a book on Amazon, and you bought two books, and that information is passed to the next guy, mm-hmm. and he's actually getting benefit out of this information, like, okay, these two books should go together.
Mm-hmm. Reading articles?
Yeah, reading articles, or maybe just, again, tagging photos. So if I like a picture and say, okay, I just tag it as a C, and next time one person looking for a picture which has C something, and he writes C, and he sees a picture of an ocean or something. So this is how it works. And I think all of you are familiar with this kind of trouble in computer science. So this is
to access something, you put in a keyword.
Exactly. And of course, I want to thank you very much that you don't blame computer scientists just because of putting this. But this is the system that we should not put, because it's like we are inviting you to a shop, and then on the door I say, now you can't get in. Show me that you are human. So this is something like that. So we are inviting you to come to a website. We're asking you, like, okay, come and join Facebook. And when you are trying to join, it gives you a trouble. They say, like, you cannot join unless you tell this. Approximately 20 million capture types every day. 200 million. And if you just take 10 seconds of each, it's about 500,000 hours a day. So 500,000 of hours human computation is wasted. So then now let's go back to the concept of social computing. How can we utilize this power? So they invented recapture. So it's just capture, just recapture. Okay. So what do they do with this capture? So whenever you are typing, just the concept of recapture is, since you are typing, you are doing some human processing, so then let's go back to a processing power where that computer cannot process, and then put that information into a format so that you do this processing job. Maybe I show a little video. Okay.
Hi everyone. I'm sure most of you have seen those squiggly characters that you have to type all over the internet. For example, when you're getting a Gmail account or CAPTCHA, when you're buying tickets online for a show that search the whole web for unprotected blogs in which they can send basically comments that advertise their products. One possible solution against this is to use a CAPTCHA to make sure that only humans can comment on your blogs. There are many other cases in which captures are necessary to prevent automated abuse, such as account sign-ups, forms in which people can contact you, etc. Now, because we here at Google hate spam as much as you do, we provide a free captcha service called ReCAPTCHA. Here I'm going to explain a few things about why ReCAPTCHA is so cool and why it's so successful at stopping automated abuse. First, I should say that ReCAPTCHA is fundamentally different from every other captcha out there. And to explain why, it's worth saying how we originally got the idea for ReCAPTCHA. Okay, so basically about 3 years ago, We did this calculation. We calculated, we wondered how many captures are typed every day by people, image for every page of the book. Okay, the next step in the process is that the computer needs to be able to decipher all of the characters that are in this image. Okay, and the reason for that is so that it can search through the book. This is done using a technology called OCR for optical character recognition. Okay, so OCR takes an image with text in it and tries to decipher what the text in that is in it is. Okay, now the problem with OCR is that it doesn't always work very well. For things that were written a long time ago, because the ink has faded and the pages have turned yellow, OCR cannot recognize many of the characters. So in this example, on the screen, if you run OCR on this, if you try to get the computer to decipher all of these characters, here's what you get. Okay, so basically, you can see all the mistakes that this makes. So what we're doing now is we're taking all of the words that the OCR cannot recognize, we're taking all the words that the computer cannot recognize in the book digitization process, and we're using CAPTCHAs so that the answers that people enter in CAPTCHAs are being used to help us correct these mistakes. Okay, so that's the fundamental idea of reCAPTCHA, is that the answers that people enter are used to correct the mistakes in the book digitization process. So let me explain the exact process of how this works. So first we start with a scan of an old book. Then we take all the words that the computer cannot recognize. It turns out the computer actually tells us when it cannot recognize a word. So we're going to take all the words the computer cannot recognize, and we're going to use these as the basis for a CAPTCHA. Notice these are perfect for a CAPTCHA because these are, by definition, words that the computer cannot recognize. Okay, so we take this word, we distort it even further to really make sure that the computer cannot recognize it, and then we use this as a CAPTCHA. Now, you may be wondering, how can we use this word as a CAPTCHA if the system doesn't know the answer for it? This is a word that the system just took out of a book for which it didn't know the answer. It should be the case that if we use it as a CAPTCHA somewhere, when you're buying tickets online, for example, we should only let you through if you type the word correctly. But how can the system do this when it doesn't know the answer? The solution to this problem is that whenever we give a user a word for which the system doesn't know the answer, we actually give it to them along with another word, one for which we do know the answer, one for which the system does know the answer. So we actually give the user two words, one for which the system knows the answer, one for which it doesn't, and we ask them to type both words. Well, of course, we don't tell the users which word is which, and if the user...
Yeah, I think the concept is clear by now. So it's like, it's giving two words, one is known and one is completely unknown from a book or a newspaper. So each time people is trying, say, if there are like two words, like between and another word, let's say, between two. So it is given to like 10 persons, and if the, say, out of 10 persons, 8 persons do the two pair of words correctly, then the computer accepts the next word as a correct word, or this distorted word as between. So how they use this completely unutilized human power to automate the scanning process? And using this concept, entire newer times was digitized, and of course for free.
Well, not completely for free, because we spend double the time. You just calculated 500,000 hours a day or something, and now we get two words instead of one. So,
yeah, but the thing is, like, now we have utilized that unutilized time. Maybe we have increased slightly, but we, and again, for the calculation, we say it's 10 seconds, but in reality, maybe it's much more. Sometimes we cannot actually do it in 10 seconds. Yeah, so yeah, but that, I think, I mean, not additional investment of from the side of, yeah. Can I go to the next slide? Yeah. And another example is, again from Amazon, it's called Amazon Human Processing or Mechanical Turks. So you can give tasks to this service and they can analyze and submit back to you. So here is the strong definition of social computing. Then, in terms of social computing, it has to do with supporting competitions that are carried out by groups of people in an idea that has been popularized by James. I can't pronounce his name. So it's like crowdsourcing. Okay. And in the weak term, when we talk about social computing, we refer to creation of blogs, writing our social networking systems, or using online commerce, etc. So in simple terms, I explain social computing as creating a lighthouse in the real world. So someone created a lighthouse because he wanted to save his boat or his land, or he wanted to guide his own ship, but all the other ships are getting benefit out of it. And then let's look at a couple of examples that we actually, these are all the examples we mentioned is the related works or other research that we did. And here is a small example of what we did. So we developed some Android systems. For one example is like Android translation systems. So you can actually take a picture of anything that you cannot translate, you cannot understand, and you can pass it to your social network and they can reply with the correct answer and you can verify. And so we created a car variety thing, but a lot of other people created a similar thing. So when you are taking your car from, let's say, UCD to city center, so there are 3 underutilized seats. So this system can actually invite other people to come along with you. So now already I think other companies before us made it commercially available. And one nice example is called, I call crowdsource childcare or crowdsource parenting. So if you have a small kid, I have about 3 years. So he will be asking one question, I don't know how many million of times. For example, what is this? So as a parent, you can actually take a picture of what is this, or for maybe what, this is an apple and A is for apple. So this system, you can use this system to do that. So you take a picture of a fish and say F is for fish, and then share it with the system. And all the some other parents who are subscribed to the same system can also use, can add more, like F is for something else. And well, it was created by one of my students. And now I'm going from social computing to social network analysis. So this is social network analysis is like it's 21st century, it's one of the most, buzzword I should say. And we can use the social computing frameworks or social computing inventions to analyze the social to have data from the social network. We can use Web2 technologies to gather information from the users. This is an example from 1935. Scientist Davis, he spent some time and observed 12 employees exchanging, interacting with each other. And it was one of the cited or most cited example. But in 2003, like, that's another example. In 2003, now we can actually analyze thousands of persons interacting with each other. Well, now we have the ability to understand more people or analyze the interaction from more people, but the problem is we also lost something. This is first-hand observation. People are observing in situ observation, but now we're just using some digitized information. But again, it made the life more easier. But the thing is, now we can also see that people, when you are observing in their office environment, or if you are just checking how they're interacting, or through email or post, they express less information to the researcher, or they don't express information in the physical world. They are sometimes express more information in their digital life, on Facebook or maybe on Twitter. So this is also an opportunity to go get more insight about the people. And about location awareness and other contextual information, we can actually translate this concept into mobile technologies so that now we can get much more information about people. It's like social scientists used to dream maybe 100 years ago, okay, if we could put a helicopter on a person and what he's doing all the day. Now we can do all these observations some of those observations using mobile technologies. And it gives a better understanding of the user behavior. Oops. And so this is a very quick example of Irish water. I was just playing with online data, how is this Irish water protest going on, and you see. it's a work of maybe 2 hours or less than that. So quickly we can see like how the interaction is evolving over time.
Sorry, let's just go back. What do you mean? What are you showing there?
These dots are small groups of people interacting with each other and talking about Irish
culture.
Online, yes.
Okay.
On a Facebook page.
Facebook page.
Yeah.
Okay.
So they are talking with each other, and this size actually shows how much they are talking about this work. And these are the links with their, like maybe someone, the center means they are starting the conversation. Some people goes from the center to far, and maybe they are not communicating with the center anymore, or maybe it's in a different city, but I didn't look at the places.
Okay.
Yeah, so my point is like now things are slightly easier with big amount of data with these social computing systems. But in the previous, when we are observing a small number of people, when we are observing people in their offline environment, we can observe less number of people, but we can get more data, more insight. But this also can be like, if we have too many people, then that can actually compensate. So now I am moving to the connected living part of this talk. So whenever we are using online social network or using our mobile phone, we are, one way or another, we are getting more and more connected in this digital world. And we are also in a time where we are actually talking about embedding sensors even in our houses. So even on the heater or on the kettle. So all things are slowly getting connected, and we are in time of living in that society. For example, connected living is also a concept from, it's also multidisciplinary. Different people from different disciplines are also looking at how this connectedness could be utilized. For example, for the mobile computing, people are talking about thinking of saving people's life using a mobile health service. Or maybe in providing proper information, we can actually we can reduce the wastage of food or the materials during the transportation, and that can also save lives. And here I'm partly working in another project called Authentic, so this is also about connectedness. So let's say here is a house and it has a lot of sensors, and you have systems that you can communicate with these systems, but how can we use all this knowledge for elderly people? That's because, let's say, in the society, we are being connected, but this society is very rapidly changing. And one example, I just recently found that from the year 2008, quarter of a million Irish people left Ireland. And they are all adult. They went to work, or they got a job, or for higher education, they went somewhere else. And all of them left their parents. And they're kind of alone. And the thing is, those parents, they don't like to ask their children to come back, or they don't like to complain, because they don't like their children to feel sad out of it that they left. But the thing is there anything that we can do using social computing? Can we give them some mental support or social support? I pose this question, and I think it could be a project idea that we can discuss in some other seminar. And about 1% people do have reduced mobility in Ireland, and many of them use wheelchairs, and sometimes those people also feel disconnected from the society. Can we make something, some innovative thing for them? Or what about the people with early dementia? Of course, when they have high dementia, we cannot do a lot of things with computational systems, but what can we support them with some social computing systems? So here comes the thought of well-being of a connected world, a connected society. And how can we actually remain connected to the latest health system? Or can we monitor our health on a daily basis? And can we really use it to improve our quality of living? And actually here comes our third area of today's talk, It's PatNet. And Diane already nicely introduced what is PatNet. So PatNet is about patient network, but it's much more. So it's like patients, their wearable sensors, their caregivers, their doctors network. So this system, the system we built can be used to manage human resource, can be used to keep track of your health data, can be used to keep track of your interaction with the medical professionals, etc. So actually people are, the motivation is people are increasingly becoming health conscious. I'm not sure, maybe some of you are already wearing wearable sensors and tracking how well you slept, or how much you ran today, or how many calories you burned today. So can we use this information? And within the Irish concept, actually there is no one framework that actually handles this kind of data or to understand the people well-being and the interaction. And in broad landscape, if you look at internationally, there is almost nothing. There are connected living concepts, but they are not taking this problem as a holistic problem. So what's the problem here? Basically, in medical science, the problem is we have abundance of data. When a patient go to a doctor, the doctor can only see from a small window of time, maybe talking to the patients for 10 minutes. And he's saying, okay, I'm feeling ill, and maybe he's talking about some sleep pattern or some illness. But from all the knowledge or all this observation, it's very difficult to find a proper, neatly organized piece of information that the doctor can use. Of course, doctors are observing you and making the laboratory test, etc., etc. But they don't have any idea or very little idea about your living style. So this is the traditional approach. So patients are going to doctor 1 or doctor 2 or doctor N, and they are telling about their problem. Doctors are giving the solutions, and sometime later these patients are going online, because now we have social computing systems, we have online social networks and these kind of networks, and they're discussing about their problems sometime. And doctors are also going to their professional network, writing papers, and discussing information. The basic problem with this, if I put with an example of cancer, it has a lag of 5 years. Because with the trial and error and all these tests, doctor actually observe one case for 5 years and then they decide what's going on, but it's already too late. But for some other diseases, maybe we can, if we can observe more than one or too many patients at the same time from a bigger perspective, we can find a pattern.
Sorry, Nasim, can you just go back a little bit? I didn't understand what you meant about the cancer example. Why does it take 5 years to
Because this is inside the medical ethics, that they observe one patient, they prescribe, they observe all these symptoms and look at if he's living for 5 years, and then they only comment on it.
You mean to share the information with other professionals?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. So it's the same for any for cancer. It's very long, but for other diseases, it's also like even if a doctor is observing, say, 10 patients for, say, 1 month, you know, in a year, and he found something, and when he's going to express his finding, it's already 1 year, or maybe 6 months. So probably we can, I mean, this is an additional, added advantage to reduce time. And when patients are discussing about their problem on an online social network, the information is scattered, so as a data scientist, as a social scientist, it's very difficult for us to gather all this data. And there's a second problem, it's called uncontrolled flow of information. Sometimes patients are sharing their example or experience, and some other patient might take it, which is probably not the best solution, so there's no one to oversee. There's no one to take care of this. But using PatNet, we can actually solve this problem, because there we can have doctors or medical personnel who can observe the discussion, and sometimes they can guide. And as I mentioned, like, it's time consuming, and of course, and for them In the existing approach, all the medical tests are laboratory tests only, so doctors do not have a pattern of your life.
And so the PatNet will bring all these different path of observation into one place, so that will be one observation, and we hope it will save time. And now we still have patients, a network of patients and network of doctors, or network of patients and caregivers and network of doctors. The basic components in PatNet are three components. Like on the left is users and their caregivers, and on the right is their social network and their interactions in the social network, and their patients' wearable sensors. So what we want to achieve, or what we want to see, so we want to see the patients in their interaction, their patients are interacting in their online social network, and maybe in some cases on the top left you can see, like, if the patient is younger and maybe doesn't have enough access to online social network, or maybe is unable for some ability related issues that he cannot type or something, so his caregiver can act on his behalf. And also this is the wearable sensor that he is using, the patient is using, so we can also extract this data and put it somewhere in a safe place, and then we can analyze to find patterns, etc. And of course it will save our time. And so still, if you are curious what is PatNet, it's in simple, it's a specialized social network engine dedicated to target user group and network of humans and sensors. So this is the human and sensor part of our discussion. I think I can skip this. This is the illustration of security. The basic building blocks we have, main core interest is about patient data. And we have like doctors, caregivers, the community interaction, their sensor data, and the user interaction, and how the interaction evolves over time, we can see using this network. And how do we collect user data? User can provide their data directly, for example, blood pressure. So it's like a human as sensor. But we also have sensor as sensor, like wearable sensor, like that can give you a sleep pattern or the calorie burned. Doctor can also provide data on about patient to patient group. So how does it look? It looks something like the familiar online social network. So the people are already familiar. So it's like that. And so there is a, like say, sensor on the top, there's a panel called sensor paint where you can actually see the amount of, say, distance you ran, the amount of distance your social network ran, or how better or how much are you, how good you are doing within your social network. This is something about privacy licensing. I think I can safely skip it. And we do have some really big challenge with using online with the sensors with the online network, because the sensors are coming from different vendors, and they do these heterogeneous sensors have different kind of protocol to access. But so far the PatNet is actually mostly generic, so most of the sensors could be translated into ASCII or XML, so probably you can access a wide range of sensors. And still we have some problem with some continuous data stream. For example, if you are sensing your heartbeat, so it's a very rich data, so how can we handle that? This is a challenge for us. And the future direction, but anyway, this is the end of the discussion, but what's the future direction of PatNet? So we think that if everything goes well, this can actually change how we see medical or care system today. So if you look at like 20 years ago, people used to go to the shop and ask the shopkeeper to prepare maybe a bread. So he used to cut it and piece it and give it to you. But now you go to the shop, you take the bread, you scan it, you pay yourself. So the duty from the shopkeeper has been completely transferred to the customer. And of course, in case of medical situation, it will not be like that, but it will definitely change. it will, the care system will definitely change. And since PatNet is a very versatile device, it's customizable, we can actually translate the system to do many other collaborative tasks. And one task may be collaborative research. So if you are doing research in this university and someone is from another university, we can use this kind of platform to alleviate, to improve the quality of interaction. And yes, if you have any questions, thank you.
Okay, I'm just going to ask, I think, Nasim, thank you very much for that idea, but I think it will be useful if Travis then presents his slides, and then we have some opportunity for questions and answers.
Hi, so my name is Travis Tatum, and this is my first year and first semester here at UCB. I recently finished a master's program at another university here in Dublin, so I've been in Dublin for a little over 1 year, and I feel very privileged to be a part of this, of the PatNet team. I originally entered the program with another proposal, but there was an opportunity here, and so I guess I sort of took the baton, if you will, from another student who went to a different project. So I feel quite privileged to be a part of this project. And it's exciting. It seems like there's a lot of potential, and I'm really happy to be a part of it. So what I'm going to present to you, other than this slide, there's only 5 other slides, so it's going to be quite a bit shorter and more concise, in the sense, maybe because I don't have that much to offer. So I'm just going to give you, I don't have as much to offer as the others on the team. So I'm going to give you a taste of what we've been looking at with PatNet and how that might look in a thesis for a PhD. So the title so far is Measuring the Effectiveness of Chronic Disease Management Among Patients in an Online Social Network. So the online social network being PatNet, and we're going to be measuring how it affects chronic disease management. So 1 of 5. Behavior modifications can help improve chronic health conditions. So I just put some very sort of blunt statements, which are sort of the extract from the abstract that's in development right now. So behavior modifications can help improve chronic health conditions, and people's social networks are related to these modifications. So if I have 5 friends and they all decide to eat better, that affects me. They're my friends, they're making a decision, and that can affect my behavior. So one interesting thing that came out in the literature is that groups that were basically artificially formed groups compared to what you might call it, in my term, an organic group. Artificially formed or intentionally designed groups also have those positive effects on health outcomes. The rise of social media provides an unmatched opportunity for improvements in healthcare delivery, as Nasim mentioned. Current platforms exist and have proved to be beneficial. I think the paramount example is patients like me. I think they have the most users, and they're based in the US. I actually became a patient on Patients Like Me recently, so I could just check out, actually today, I signed up to check it out. I have an intolerance to certain foods, and so that's my disease on the, not my disease, but my condition on the network. But as some of the things that Nasim mentioned, there are areas which can be improved, and that's what we're looking to do with PatNet. So the areas, I put them in 3 categories. Integration of advanced technology, for example, the biosensors, and then DNA sequencing. We may or may not be able to do that, but if we can, you can imagine that's quite a rich data set, for lack of better words, if we could incorporate someone's DNA. Then also improved usability, simplified interface and presentation of analytics, and increased monitoring. So this came from, there was a Facebook group, and this, I mean, there's probably countless Facebook groups functioning this way. But one problem with Facebook is you'll have a genuine thread, and in the middle of the thread, you know, Ryan so-and-so from wherever says, oh yeah, oh that's great that you felt like that. You know, I took this thing and it really worked. And actually it's just somebody from a company that's trying to sell the product. So the fact that physicians will be included in the network will help that problem. And researchers as well. And then tightened security. So all of the data will not be shooting back to the States, but it will be kept here at UCD. And then, yeah, this is the second last slide. So PatNet was developed to address those areas. And this is redundant at this point, but it already exists. That's one thing to get across in the proposal, is that it already exists. There's already a patient group with doctors who are signed up for the project, and we'll be using specific statistical techniques, which I'm not able to do because I am still in my first semester. So that's something that I need to learn, which is related to the evolution of the network, the social network theory, etc. So, lines of inquiry. This is the last slide. Does participation in PatNet improve patient well-being? So, for example, let's say we have a year of use, and we give them some measurements along the way, just a simple way to measure, for example, their well-being. Do they have a higher score? And are the ones who has a higher score? We're able to look at a lot of different things. Did they participate more? Does participation in PatNet lead patients to adopt healthy habits? So for example, diet, exercise, I think that's two things that we'll be focusing on. So is there, not only are they doing better, but is their behavior changed as a result of participating in the network? And are there any structural barriers to the implementation of PatNet, for example, with the physicians? So in a sense, I think in a very real sense, this is an experiment. So we'll find out a lot of things just by looking at what happens. But are the physicians, are they participating? And are some participating more than others? Or are they participating more as a result to certain analytics being fed back to them? Maybe they find, you know, maybe one type of analytic really generates a lot of participation from the physicians. And then, so if so, how about we overcome them? So that's my presentation. Thank you for this opportunity. Once again, I feel very privileged to be a part of the project and also to be able to present to you all today. So thank you.
Thanks for the presentation. So one question that, or I have a couple of questions, but one thing that leads to me is, question is, earlier you presented the juxtaposition of how sociologists traditionally did research with the surveys, and now with a lot of digitized information in social media, you can do a whole lot of social network analysis. But one question I have is, especially in the with this PatNet project, is how do you incorporate a protocol? Because with surveys, you have a very tight control on the protocol. I suppose, your research field. With social network analysis, you have biases, you have mostly young people, you have those that are engaged with the social media, and you also have missing information that you cannot control for. So I'm just wondering how this pans out in PatNet, and how we can then address issues like efficiency of healthcare management.
So I'm both chairing, but I'm also obviously involved in the project. So the uses of PatNet are, this is not a public platform, this is a private platform.
So all the users of PatNet are either health professionals or patients who have agreed to sign up to PatNet and to integrate, to engage in the project. So in the signing up to PatNet, they are advised that the research will be asking, first of all, we know who is signing up in the sense of what they are, what age they are, what their demographics are. So there are no young people. I mean, what Nasim presented here were some of the applications where PatNet may be taken. So for example, it could be that in another project we would, might like to look at young people as patients. In this particular project, we're not going to do that. We're looking, all of the users are adults. So, and in the signing up to the project, there's a very clear protocol in terms of what kind of information we'll be gathering from them and how that data will be used and how it will be stored. We've created a secure server which is housed here in UCD, and the data is not made available to others outside of the project, and only made available to those within the project on certain clear criteria. So we've worked actually with a company who has designed these kinds of platforms for the sharing of financial data, for example, and they're very rigorous in the way in which they've organized the security levels for the collection and the sharing of data. It's unknown to us yet, for example, whether or not we will be able to collect. So a lot of what you're seeing here is our vision for where we might take this project. It's unknown to us yet, for example, and we probably don't expect that patients' data will be shared by doctors other than between a doctor and his or her patient. This is an experiment. To date, doctors do not share data, for example, like this. But at the moment, there isn't any real vehicle to provide an opportunity to allow doctors to share data in this way. So in a way, we're trying to create a platform wherein we can explore those as experiments to see under what conditions would a medical team, for example, allow the sharing of data. The doctors and the patients are all working on a condition that's not cancer. It's a much more moderate, less critical medical condition that the patients are defined by or conditioned by. So in that sense, we've tried to create a project and a first set of experiments where we are definitely very aware of all of the, for example, ethical issues that we might need to take account of, and the security issues and the confidential issues that we need to take account of. They're very, very, very front and center in this research. As the patient engage on PatNet, they are the way in which they can share data is no different amongst themselves in terms of information, is no different to what they might be able to do in a public server, in the sense that they may choose on a public server to share their sentiments, their experiences of their visits to the doctor. That may happen. The difference here is that we create an environment that is entirely secure for those patients, and they're aware of that. So the question then becomes, if you create an environment that's secure, what will happen to the sharing of data? What will happen to the behaviour as a result of the sharing of that data? Does that answer your question? Or have I missed anything?
One thing that interests me particularly is actually the protocol and workflow of physicians in recording data. So it seems like some sensor information that maybe patients might have themselves, or heart rates and things like that, blood pressure, and it is continuously monitored. You like this data is owned by the patient and can easily be shared relatively, right? But diagnosis codes, laboratory tests,
yeah.
And the workflow associated with for each physician and following a patient's health progress,
yeah.
That protocol is first of all different between doctors themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And I was wondering whether PatNet imposes such a protocol to collect data systematically to be able to compare those workflows if that is the line of research between those physicians.
So in terms of imposing a schedule for data collection, we at the moment have two mechanisms. One will be the traditional survey type questions, which we will put to patients and doctors alike. There'll be different kinds of survey questions. The inputting of data from doctors, as I've said, at this point, it's at a very low level because it is a process that you negotiate as a during the project. I think this is something that is an experiment in a sense, and I think there's a certain level of engagement that needs initially to be established and then we build it. So we see it as a series of pilots evolving, and I think that is entirely appropriate because it's very hard to see into the future in terms of what might be potential challenges. So in that sense, I think we're trying to do as much as we can to map the kinds of ways in which people share data. Patients may themselves may share, they will communicate online by texting, by messaging and all of that. That data is also something we can mine, is also something we can analyze in terms of how they discuss their care and so forth. Ideally, we would love doctors to do likewise. Again, then we may have another avenue for mapping the sharing of data and the mechanisms by which data are collected. But that's as far as we have got at this point in the project.
I'd
be very interested to hear more from you. Yeah. I suspect you have a lot to
say. I know someone whose sons have cystic fibrosis.
Yeah.
And he went beyond doctors to find on the internet in specialized social media for advice of what other people do. Like and he uses very much. I couldn't say it's medical advice. I don't know much about it, but he very much follows in this very tight network, I suppose, of people who have these or report on those conditions across the world, and may also report on whether something is working or not. I can see how PubMed is kind of addressing this to combine patients or number of patients who have something in common.
And the danger is that it is unsupervised. That is the real challenge. That it's a perfect vehicle for sharing and learning really quickly. But if you do it in a public sphere without any oversight, then it becomes actually something that could be difficult. I think, Nasim, would you mind if I just ask?
Just very briefly, do you mind if I affirm each of you, because it's as much to do with the direction of the mic for picking up your questions as getting on camera.
Sure.
You're
on camera.
So I think it's a very interesting project with an interesting potential. My question would be, one of the reasons why people like things like patients like me is the anonymity. So they can discuss, it's not a safe environment in terms of it's not on a secure server, but it's a safe environment in terms of they very much can choose what information they share, what information they don't share. And there is a certain support structure that forms through that anonymity. Whereas I just wonder how much is being taken away by the patients being aware their doctors have access to this information. For example, let's say they're meant to take a certain medication, but they shouldn't mix it with alcohol, so they're kind of sharing information like, well, I skipped my pill, do you think that's okay? And they kind of turn to each other for advice on this. Again, you're right, it's not supervised, and it's not medically supervised information, but they're turning to each other for support on these decisions. Or maybe they're having a hard time talking to their doctor about something, and they turn to each other. My wonder was, how much of that support structure are you taking away by sharing the information with the doctors?
In PatNet, actually, each piece of information, when it is shared, it has its own metrics of access level. So the patient actually can see what the doctors are saying, or in some for some medical conditions, it really depends. So
they can see what the doctor is saying, or they can't?
They can see. The thing is, now it depends on the level of access that you are providing. So if you are chatting, if you are discussing, you can remain anonymous. You can even hide the whole discussion.
So from your doctor as well?
Yeah.
Okay, that was...
So it's actually people interacting with their own responsibility. But of course, like if someone is writing a blog or just sharing an advice, so he is ethically bound to share that who is giving this advice to whom. And in that case, doctor can actually see who is giving this advice. And there's no harm that doctor can see that you have advised one medication or one way of sleeping. And the doctor, as a moderator, can actually then intervene and correct if there is something wrong. So,
yeah, I'm just wondering how much, though, having that supervised aspect is going to influence how much people share. Because it's like, you know, kids in school knowing the teacher's listening, it's
going to
be a little different.
Inside PatNet, it is one of the most complicated, complex problem. It's just to define one such matrix, who can see, when can see, and what can see. So we are concerned about it. So.
Yeah. So, I mean, the question is empirical, isn't it? You know, it's in a sense, at the moment we are looking at the PatNet project, and we have set up it as an experiment with certain within that we know what we know in a sense.
Mm-hmm.
Another, you know, addition to that would be, and it has been proposed to us, that we have a control group of patients, with the same condition, and maybe we provide, maybe we map them offline, or we provide some sort of like empty PatNet with no, you know, or some create some sort of equivalent to our PatNet and explore what that control group, how that control group behaves.
Mm-hmm.
But that's another project. I don't know if it's necessary to have the control group to justify what's happening or to be able to understand what's happening within the PatNet project, but I definitely think it would be very interesting. James?
Just as a follow-up, because I was thinking about this idea of a control group as well, because I mean, I see the potential, right? But I don't think, and there is a very important potential there. I think it would be very interesting to see what happens. But the questions that were posed about, you know, how does it impact upon health? I mean, you cannot answer them without a control group, right? Because there's no way of isolating the causal effect of the social network. So you need... And you need the control group to be designed in such a way that it's not chosen from the same doctors, right? It's very difficult to design that control group because, you know, the doctors that sign up for a social network are already probably quite engaged with, you know, new ways of treating patients. So, you know, a treatment to control group taken from their own patients is not going to be perfect. So, in order to make the claims that you want to make and test the actual effectiveness of this, which I think is very doable, but that control group is very important. And then another question I had, and it's kind of related to what patients share, right? And the idea that the social network is private is nice because that does provide some protection, right? But at the same time, I mean, you know, the famous problem of Googling health problems on the internet, you get all sorts of terrible advice. Patients chatting, even in a private setting, are going to be chatting about all sorts of things. So how do you get the signal from the noise there, as it were? Because I'm sure they're going to have, I mean, lots and lots of different things to talk about. And if there's lots and lots of text, how do you get at the important parts of that whole corpora of text? That's quite challenging. Not impossible.
Yeah.
I don't want to put it up loads of problems.
Yeah, yeah. No, so I mean, the control group idea is a very attractive idea. It's doable, but it's probably going to be an offline control group.
Yeah.
At the moment, we have one clinical group and one, and the patients, and there are, you know, belong. So at the moment, I don't know if we will get another similar clinical group to be really able to distinguish, you know, one group of clinicians as opposed to another group of clinicians. So that problem may remain. But that's just, I mean, anybody working in this field, getting access is very, very difficult.
But I mean, if you do get that control group,
it would be the best,
that would
first,
be
best next step. Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
And that would be something I think we could do for sure. It would be offline. It wouldn't be a sort of empty PatNet.
Yeah.
We would map one patient group and then. The issue of noise, so, you know, I think that's what would happen because patients, they, you know, you naturally start to build friendships and then you start to talk about all kinds of other things as well as. And so the text mining part of it, which is where we start to work with our computer science friends, the techniques for doing that we will work collaboratively with folk from Insight.
Sure, you can get trending topics on Twitter now. You can get breaking news on Twitter. Storyful was bought recently by News Corp. They did well with breaking news. So there's lots of computer science ways of doing that. But it's still very technically ambitious from trying to collect sensor data seamlessly into and then make it available somehow to the physicians through the social network is no trivial, unless it's the same sensor you're always giving out to the same crowd.
That's where
you know,
we're probably going to start. So we'll start to work with one called Field and you know, similar, share their sensor technology so that we have that platform basis from where to go, and we have sort of a set of other studies that have used those similar sensors.
So
not in the same kinds of projects.
In the core of this, what I got out of this was that it's a platform, a monitored platform for conversation. That's really, if you strip off everything, the data, the fancy data collection through sensors and all of that, ultimately what you're saying is you're trying to give people a space to have a conversation which is monitored by a group of physicians, and you want to see how that space actually evolves, if it's better than the unmonitored sort that goes on the internet at the moment, or if it leads to any more insights, that kind of stuff.
That's one, you know, core. But within that is also because we work with clinicians, we would expect to have, you know, a baseline measurement of their health level, their health condition.
Sure.
And to be able to track that over time. It's a condition that's
sure,
not,
yeah, so
it's not life-threatening.
Yeah.
Okay?
It's measurable in the sense
measurable,
after a year
and it's
or
not
then.
Invasively measurable. It's measurable by techniques which we all have access to.
Then the trick is to see how the social network aspect of that affected their improvement
exactly.
as opposed to
other Yeah, but also by engaging with clinicians in that discussion, because that is the interesting additional part to the process. To what extent will clinicians start to engage in this conversation as well, and to use this data amongst themselves to compare across similar kinds of cases?
Sure.
Nasim, do you
sorry.
Want to
explain?
Sorry.
Can I ask one
last question?
I'm just curious about, so the reason doctors don't publish findings when they're in the experimental phase is they don't want to give unsubstantiated advice. What can be done here in terms of, let's say someone gives advice saying ginger root and cinnamon are going to help with this particular problem, and the doctor's meant to come in and what is going to be their role there? Are they going to cut it down, even though it's maybe a slightly homeopathic remedy that hasn't been scientifically proven yet, versus there is maybe some evidence to suggest it's in the works or something like that? Like, what is going to be their job to say, don't follow this advice, or say, that's interesting, you can give it a try, but it's unsubstantiated, or?
First, I should say, I had, in my presentation, I had a backup slide. And the backup slide was this question. So what would doctor really say?
Yeah.
The straight answer is we don't know. So it completely depends on the doctor. And sometimes, for example, it also biased or influenced by culture. In one culture, maybe doctor can say, okay, even if you have cold, you can drink cold water. In another culture, they really strictly say, no, you should not drink cold water. So it definitely depends on the doctor or how he is either by culture or ethically bound to answer. But I don't think, it's just my assumption, I don't think that doctor will just cut down because something is not yet proven by science. Because we of course, do follow our natural course of interaction when we in our social form. So it's a social platform. So people can choose to eat something which is not yet known as harmful, or not yet also known as something better.
The doctor is not held accountable, I suppose.
So this is,
exactly.
As I said, this, yeah.
Okay.
To bring the sociology back in, the sociologists in the room, of which there are now so many of you. So the starting point for the project was this frustration and fascination with the differences across health systems. So in Ireland, we do have a very hierarchical health system. We have clinicians at the top of the tree, and patients somewhere down near the base of the tree, and the relationship is very dyadic in network terms. It's your doctor and you as the patient, and the changes in the health system in Ireland over the past say 10 years have started to move us towards team-based health groups, where we have a clinician having to work with other therapists in team-based approaches to the provision of care to the patient. But the patient was supposed to be brought into that team, and hasn't really been brought into that team in a meaningful sense, it seems, if we look at primary care interventions, for example. And here we have a form of communications. It's getting back to Pragza, go to the core of what the project's about. The interesting thing is that this technology has potentially the possibility of disrupting that kind of relationship, because it creates a form of communication that allows patients to share information and to collectivize their experience and to create a sense of identity of I'm no longer a patient with my doctor. I am a patient with other patients who share similar conditions. I am part of a group. And that creates a whole new dynamic. For sociologists, they then begin to wonder, what happens to the experience of the patient then in terms of how they interact in this organizational setting? And how do they interact with their doctor or their clinical team in this organizational setting? So that's really interesting. For me as a sociologist, that's really interesting. What way does the technology impact? We may only observe that as a byproduct of a very concrete project that we're, it's also very interesting to explore from the point of view of the health practitioners, how they interact and all of those kinds of questions. But stepping back from it, we can also ask the question, what does this do in terms of this profession? Because it's not just this profession, it's many other areas of life.
I'm sorry, I missed the opening part. So I was in a meeting and got delayed, so I don't know who was covered. But on the last point you raised here about this, the doctor-patient relationship and the notion of the doctor's the nominal inclusion of patients, have you drawn on the literature on expertise? Harry Collins, one of the founders of the sociology or the social studies of science in the 1970s, recently tried to introduce a kind of thought that the social studies of science had gone too far in the direction of critiquing scientific and medical authority and gone all populist with respect to everybody has knowledge, all patients know their own position better than anything else. So we tried to rehabilitate things by introducing a concept of participative expertise and interactional expertise, interactional expertise would be what you were calling the way in which a patient, particularly if they're involved in a patient group, via their own research, their experience exchanging ideas, they will learn about medicine, they will actually know a fair bit about the pharmaceuticals they're taking or the therapies or blah, blah, blah. They are able to converse intelligently with the physician who, under whose jurisdiction they are, but they do not measure up to the physician's position of them as simply lay persons who lack knowledge. And I think it might be a different way of putting it, that this kind of technology might be a way of in Colin's terms, is actually taking people and giving them interactional expertise, mm-hmm. but you're still going to be faced with what you might call the cultural problem of non-recognition of the knowledge of patients on the part of the medical professions. They will refuse to recognize that this is legitimate knowledge, that there's any credit, and I'm not so sure this technology will overcome that kind of refusal to acknowledge that these people actually do know something.
Yeah. But that's the question, in a sense, and I wouldn't be surprised that a medical profession would, and legitimately, I think, you know, feel that they have an expertise. They have an expertise. They are experts in the field. But it is the case that another strand of this research is actually where this research started, in fact. And again, I'm going back to the comment about what this project is about. Is the within the medical profession the observation that many conditions are not just about the medical intervention that you take, the drug, the operation, but are also about the behavioural support and the social support that patients have, and that there is a distinction in terms of the success rate of patients responding to interventions, which seems to reflect very closely their social support and the behaviour that they engage in managing their condition. So it's observing that, but it's also observing how doctors respond to that. Because doctors, the people we have talked to, they are very curious about that. How do we manage that and understand that and do it in a way that's rigorous? What are the techniques out there that social scientists can help us to map so that we can actually take it seriously and really try to not take it seriously in the wrong way, but can actually quantify it in some way or measure it in some way that we can say that's important, that person has a distinctly different type of social support structure to this person. I need to take that into account in terms of how I help that patient manage their condition. I think as social scientists we have a lot to offer because we have that quite well sorted out.
Just on a couple of interesting areas, the technology of networking. There's some interesting research around Twitter that kind of shows that rather than Twitter necessarily being a tool by which people exchange ideas, but it can be a way in which people entrench their position. So just because you interact on Twitter doesn't mean you look for the alternative opinion within that. But secondly, the idea that, you know, in a sense of do no harm for a doctor, that if you create a technique by which you can gather a lot of data, and by introducing things like sensors, so that the amount of data that can be collected from a patient might actually reveal other information that somebody like an insurance company might be involved in. So in a way, is there a risk that you can actually create a platform that an industry like health insurance or life insurance might then start to make demands or create expectations of a patient that they would be able to reveal information? So it's not necessarily going to be. So if somebody's in a supportive network, then that's going to make them a better bet from insurance, whereas somebody can be identified as not having a strong network, then that makes them a risk for an insurance company. And that this data is kind of ancillary to the just direct treatment of a particular symptom.
Yeah, that's definitely possible, but of course that's a business model, and we are actually not looking at that business model so far. So it's mainly we are looking at understanding the scientific outcome. So, but however, that could be an implication of this kind of system, where a business company may be interested in to understand patients and their lady lifestyle before maybe issuing an insurance, but that's out of our scope.
But there's no reason why that couldn't already be happening. You couldn't think of insurance companies when they, I don't know, are they, when you go to sign up, do they do a search? Do they try to find out what your conditions are? And
I mean, I would imagine that, say, a person's own GP would be part of the process that the patient is engaged in. And therefore, if the GP is aware of something that's not necessarily related to the program itself, but has been caught by the sensors, then the doctor is obliged to answer truthfully about the medical conditions of an individual. So straight off, and then as it would develop.
Yeah, that is.
Which, of course, is not a good reason not to pursue this line, but it may have implications further down from that point of view. And doctors, therefore, may have to take account of the fact that they may be put in a position that they have more data than they necessarily need, and therefore cause some kind of harm.
Yeah, but these are questions that are outside, not to duck the issue necessarily, but they are questions that are outside of the scope of this project. It is very much a research project, and the data belongs to the research project. As Nasim said, that's potentially it could be where this kind of technology goes, but that's a legal and business conundrum, I think. But it's a little bit like sort of trying to put the genie back in the bottle. It's out.
If you go for a job somewhere, nowadays more and more employers, just in the form, they ask you, can you put down your Facebook details and your, like, a login for your Facebook, or what's your LinkedIn profile and also your Twitter. So in these places, they're already invading your private life, and you'd be surprised how much of your data is out there. In this project, I think the data aspect confuses me a little bit when compared to the conversational or the creating a platform where a doctor is available. They seem to me to be two separate tracks that somehow should merge together. The data sharing isn't obvious to me from the platform that you're creating, but it's obvious that platform could be used from a conversational perspective to either reach out, in the worst case scenario, to just reach out to your physician to ask him a question every so often, or it becomes more collaborative. But the data collected through your sensor watch and all of that is maybe you have it somewhere, but it doesn't, in my mind, exactly fit into how that feeds into somebody else seeing that data, or even what to do with that data, or even how to present that data to the end user, or even back to yourself. All of these are kind of open research questions, how to nudge people. So there's a lot going on here that you mentioned that are all research topics in themselves, and I wouldn't hurry putting those into your platform.
Yeah, no, you're right. We have thought about this as a kind of a staged approach, and the intention was simply that you want to try to motivate the participation of the user. So at this point, being able to give that feedback and within a broader context, that's the idea that we're trying to. But the next step after that.
The question related to this underlying social network analysis that you're aiming to do, do you have a handle between offline and online social network? Because I suppose if patients connect with themselves online, there is an entirely different behavior than the offline network. If you have a supportive family, supportive friends, and all who are really integrated into your illness or whatever. So being able to, I suppose, analyze or differentiate between those two is really quite interesting. I suppose Fowler and Christakis and others worked with the Framingham heart study data and studied modifiable risk factors for chronic disease and all that. But that is very much survey-based, right? So I see that with PatNet and SNA, you can go much deeper because you are focusing also on the interaction, on the continuous collection of data and how things evolve.
So let me make a plea now. It's me, Nasim, and Travis. If somebody else would like to come along with another PhD student who'd like to do this work, you know, we're wide open to collaboration. So yeah, it's like another project. And it's not an unimportant project, but the project is about online communication. We may try to map in ego networks what are your support networks around you, but I'm not going to, at least I don't think we're thinking yet of talking about mapping the offline network on each individual. But that is a project that would be lovely to have running alongside this project, and we would be delighted to collaborate. If there's a number of other projects, we are looking to collaborate, because you know it's a big field.
So for this project, we have our patients are invited only. So we know that they're individual patients visiting one hospital, for instance, but not necessarily their offline friends. But when they come on board, could be that over time they become friends. So we are not in this project going to track back how that interaction going, impacting either offline interactions or offline interaction is impacting online. I think as Dan mentioned, that could be a completely separate.
There's an equivalent of this in the real world in terms of all the blogs, when you ask for support, for example, you go to a Microsoft site or something, so you type in, and they have a moderator that goes about doing the sort of stuff you want your physicians or doctor to be doing.
Okay.
So there's real equivalence of this, and they cut down some conversations that are not part of that thread. They move a thread on to another conversation if that's more suitable there.
Right.
And they intervene every time. They don't intervene all the time, but there's people whose jobs are to monitor these interactions. So if someone's given out about your product or service, you can prevent them or present them with a solution there. So there are equivalents in the real world, not in the health sector.
Yeah, but
it would be useful to see how it is.
So, okay, I want to say thank you to Nasim and Travis. This is the first time we've made this presentation in public, so thank you very much.